Should I get to your height?
If you want.
I can also raise mine.
Wait, now we're...
I'm too low. Hey, friends. Welcome to Dig It With Raven, a very, very special edition of Dig It With Raven. This is my amazing friend, Jude.
Hi.
She also hails from Canada, which is awesome. So Jude is studying something super cool here at the University of Leiden, and she's here to talk to us about it today, which is really awesome. We're going to be doing this whole series of videos for you guys, and we're going to be learning lots of stuff about...
Osteology!
Bones! It's very, very exciting. Yeah.
Oh no.
Hello. They say hi. You met me through the vlog, actually, right? Yeah.
Yep.
It's funny.
I creeped Raven.
Yes. She asked me out on an internet date.
Yeah.
Stranger danger, guys. Just beware. But no, we actually ended up at the same university at one point, just at different times, and now we're both in the Netherlands, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
LinkedIn. Fate. Yeah, LinkedIn is actually, that's like the only connection I've ever made off of LinkedIn was you.
Me too.
Yeah.
That's it. Don't start asking Raven out on LinkedIn.
No.
Okay?
Please.
I just got past.
Too many sliding into my DMs already, you know? So. But yes, Osteology 101 today. It's going to be super exciting. We're talking about bones, things I don't know anything about. So you are my resident expert. Before we start, I wanted to say a huge thank you to the University of Leiden for letting us film in their amazing osteology lab here. You can see we have the most amazing equipment and stuff for you guys. So you actually get like a legit video. We're filming on location, so it's not in my bedroom.
Yay!
Let's get started.
Okay.
Tell me about osteology. Like, what is osteology?
Osteology, to break down the word, is the study of bones, obviously. Mm-hmm. And with osteology in particular, usually we're applying it to archaeology. So you can also say osteoarchaeology. And so it's a study of bones from the past, older bones. And from that, we infer a couple of things. So we basically create a whole biological profile relative to just having this, except real life. And so that's essentially what we're doing with osteology, and with that, we could figure out a number of things.
It's kind of weird to think that this is, like, inside of me.
Yeah. We all look the same on the inside.
Right? Oh, God. It's 2018. Get woke. We're all the same on the inside.
See? We can't tell what we are here.
Look inclusivity, guys.
Yeah.
Right?
We're all one.
Anyways, my main concern is, like, this is where a child comes from.
Yeah. Yeah.
How did my head get through this?
It's woman. Good job. Yeah.
I'm afraid for my future. For archaeology people, because you're an archaeologist as well. So what do bones specifically like provide for us when we're looking at the archaeological record?
So let's say you excavate a bone on a site.
Yep.
Then it will give you more context into, I guess, how the site, when it was alive, right? And
okay.
So these people are the people that create the site. They're the foundations to a culture, they're foundations to a new city and empire, whatnot. So when you find a skeleton in the site, you're able to round out that context relative to the material that's associated with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for example, you can find a bunch of cooking pots on a site, and then you can figure out, you can infer certain things about what they ate, how they made food, how they processed their food, what they did. And then if you have the people as well, you can infer their diet. You could refine those insights that you got from the other material relative to the skeleton. And
cool.
So there's a number of things you can figure out with the skeleton. Chemical analyses and even just observation-wise.
What exactly can you, like, get from, like, a bone? Like, if you put, like, a femur in front of me or something, I'm just going to be like, yo, that's a bone.
Nice.
Yeah, right? Nice bone.
Nice bone.
But, yeah, there's, like, certain things. Like, there's markers, indicators. Like, what can you tell from, like, looking at a bone? Like, I've watched bones. Emily Deschanel, like, she's great. You know? She's cool. So you're, like, my real-life bones.
I'm cool.
So, like, yeah, and she, like, drops some knowledge and stuff, but, like, is it actually accurate? Like, what can you actually tell from, like, a bone in front of you?
So, bones isn't the worst, but you can figure out a number of things. And
okay.
So, for example, talking about one skeleton. So, you have one skeleton in front of you. You know it's from one person. So, you could first infer their biological profile.
Okay.
And what that means is you can determine an age estimate. So, with age, you can infer kind of an estimate. So, it's not always the most accurate. We'll never say that they're specifically this age. And also, remember, it's age at death. And there's also a difference between the age of your skeleton and the age of you, for example. So, if you say you're 32, then your osteological age, your skeleton age, can be something different relative to wear and tear, relative to...
Is it like my Wii Fit age?
Yes.
Because my Wii Fit age is not very good.
Yeah, exactly. And so But you can determine an age estimate, and okay. so there's basically an age range, mm-hmm. and also there's a few methods that you use, and then you kind of create an average.
Got it.
And so those groupings could either be, so let's say you're talking about an adult, then it would obviously be over 18, and then you can have groupings. You could have early young adult, late young adult, so that would be from before your 30 or 25, basically, and then it would be upwards into your 30s and
okay.
stuff.
Okay.
And then you have older adult as well, middle adult and older adult. The thing is with older adults
yeah.
is that past 50 years old, you can't really determine anymore a very narrow age range. The younger you are, the easier it is.
Okay, so I think yeah. that's where Bones kind of gets me off, because I think they're like, it's a 70-year-old yeah. woman, and then I'm like, whoa, like that's yeah. so, and she just looks at it too, right? She's just like, bam.
Yeah.
No.
And it's not that fast.
It's like when we watch Indiana Jones, and we're like, yeah. no.
What are you doing?
What do you mean you're touching it?
Don't touch things in museums.
I have another vlog about that, don't worry.
I said the British Museum, stop touching things.
Okay, cool. So that's all about the age. What about, like, what other things can you, the sex.
Yeah. So the sex, again, not gender. Gender is a complete different thing, and gender is a complete social construct. And so we can't, you can't say you see gender in the skeleton. Like we said, we look essentially the same. We look at least very similar. And the only differences are there are certain morphological differences in the face and in the pelvis in particular mm-hmm. that determine where you're leaning on in the spectrum. And that's actually how you could say it. You could say it's a spectrum.
The spectrum. Okay, so there's no such thing as gender.
No,
because it's 2018.
That and also there never really was.
Never really was. So no such thing as gender. No. Get woke. There's such a thing as sex. There's still sex, but there's not a male, female. It's, you said it's a spectrum. So how many kind of categories between them?
So it's five. About what we currently use. And quite frankly, that can very clearly change over time.
Yeah.
But we do still use male and female. Like, those are the scientific terms you use for sex.
Okay.
And so you have male and female, but then it actually goes from male, probable male, indeterminate, probable female and female. So it's like, I'm probably. But basically, so these kind of groupings are because everyone has different traits. So you see, for instance, some people have a woman, for example, could have a very, very angular jawline. Let's talk about models here. Very angular jawline or a very robust face. So like very angular in every direction. And that's usually leaning towards the male end of the spectrum, those kind of angularities.
Oh, okay.
And so when, if I was looking at so-and-so's skeleton, and I'm looking at the skull and she has a very angular face, then it's going to lean, my markings are going to lean towards male. However, the pelvis has a better accuracy rate, and just because women, and this is the only reason why with the biological sex thing, because women biologically need to be able to give birth. So there are differences relative to that,
but
even that is not for sure.
Okay, well, because some girls got tiny hips, right?
Exactly.
Like I'm afraid to birth a child out of my hips. Okay, so there's that's cool about sex, because you see people too when they like get dressed up or like they cut their hair short, they look, some of them look very feminine, but some of them still look very like people used to think I was a man.
But we'll show some examples afterwards of kind of the difference between a male and a female. But woman, for example, will have wider hip, obviously. Wider hips, it's going to be more broad and rounded. And also when you look, if you look directly down into this little hole here, then it's going to be a lot bigger, more ovular, not ovular, circular. And then the men, it's going to be a lot narrower, a lot longer. And obviously you're not going to have as much space in that birthing canal area.
Okay, so we have age, sex.
Yes.
What else can you talk about from them?
So height or stature, you can determine to an extent or estimate to an extent.
Yeah.
And that's a lot more simpler. People can kind of come to that conclusion. Mm-hmm. Essentially, you're measuring the long bones, the things that determine your height.
Yeah, they're all kind of like on a ratio, right?
You input them. There's a bunch of different methods. And so you put them into a couple formulas and then it gets an average stature, an average centimeter height.
Nice.
And then if you're doing your measurements correctly, well then you're going to get, and if you use multiple methods, then you're going to come with a little average range. So let's say someone's 161 centimeters, and then metric system.
Metric.
Then if you use a bunch of methods, it'll probably be within like 159, 162 centimeters.
Okay.
So you can determine that.
There's like a little bit of a range.
Yeah.
But you can kind of get the general height of said person.
Yeah. There's the other elements you have to take into account that you still have this much like foot. And so, but it's an estimate, right? And so you can get a general idea. There's a difference between someone that's 150 centimeters, someone's 170.
Oh yeah.
So
okay.
You can at least get that range as well.
So these are the basics. So you got age, sex, height. I guess you can also tell their profession from, like, or what they've done strenuously throughout their time.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so this is also relative to groups, earlier populations that needed to do strenuous activity. Nowadays, a lot of us just are sitting a lot more.
Yeah, what does an office, like, 9-to-5-er look like? Like, their skeleton, just, like, their lower back is sore? Or
yeah, no, like, it messes up also your vertebrae here. Computers and phone. Our spines are getting messed up. Yeah,
get do some yoga.
This is becoming one of those inspirational public speaking.
I saw this video on osteology and it completely changed the way I live.
But like, but you can see it. So I don't know if I could bend.
Oh God.
Yeah.
Ooh. All right. So.
So you see look this. Look at this. So you're basically on your phone. It's upside down. And this is how we look at phones, right? Look at what's happening here. And we're doing this all the time, so this just gets worse. And so that's an example of things that you could see over time. It's more so just going to deform the spine a bit. And also you're gonna get pain at that point, right?
Like, that's what I get. I need like, I'm always rubbing right here.
Yeah, same. And most people are.
Because I'm always on my stories, man. Yeah. I gotta add my stories for my loyal fan base.
You're doing great.
Ah! Oh, we're high-fiving. I thought you were gonna reprimand me for being on my phone.
But also relative to sitting, office chairs, it'll mess up your lower spine too.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just not healthy. Ergonomics, guys.
Ergonomics. Thank you for your service. Okay, so there's things like that, like repetitive stress.
Yeah, that's modern example.
Things that you've done, because I remember watching another Bones example. Mm-hmm. It was like a ballet dancer and her toes were all like messed up. Yeah. And then she was like, oh, like, or tennis elbows. You could see the tennis, like it's an actual thing.
Well, you could see, so with this one, you have all these tendon and muscle markers, right?
Yeah.
And there are certain areas, so for example, in the shoulders and the elbows and knees, the hips and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
There are certain markers that, muscle markers, so for example, if you work out a lot and you, like bodybuilder, for example, or weightlifter, well then you're going to have larger muscle attachments which are in the bone. Like that's how some people determine kind of like, oh, they worked more with their right side. At that point, they were hunting and gathering. It was a guy and he's using, like we know this culture uses spears. And so he has markers around here from throwing the spear. And you can see that kind of stuff to an extent.
That's cool.
Obviously, they're all inferences. You can't be certain. I mean, we're also generalizing our inferences on what we know now.
Nice. Okay, so you can tell like kind of what they did. Like a lot of their hobbies.
Yeah.
So you do a lot of yoga? Do you see a lot of like yoga?
I don't know.
That's a new study. I'm going to do my master's in yoga bones.
There you go.
I'm loving this. Yeah. Like this is actually like so much fun.
So much more so, where that came from.
So much more. So we're going to do another episode. So make sure you really check into that next time because it's going to be really fun. Yeah. Thank you so much, Jude, again, as always, for being super smart and super cool. And thank you again to the University of Leiden for letting us film in their lab using all of their amazing real bones and fake bones. If you want to learn more about anything, any of the programs here at the University of Leiden, link to that is in my description below. Link to my website is also in the description below, where there's a nice little write-up and some extra links if you want to read some more about osteology and all the fun stuff that we were just chatting about. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, and don't forget to subscribe to Jude on the gram. Follow her, follow me, watch out for the next one, follow Leiden, all the things, and we'll catch you on the flip side. Stay dirty, my friends.